لقد كان لكم في رسول الله أسوة حسنة لمن كان يرجو الله واليوم الآخر وذكر الله كثيرا.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، صلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. قال الإمام البخاري رحمه الله تعالى في كتابه الأدب الكبير: باب قيام الرجل للرجل تعظيما. حدثنا آدم قال حدثنا
باب تقبيل اليد
حدثنا موسى قال حدثنا أبو عوانة عن يزيد بن أبي زياد عن عبد الرحمن بن أبي ليلى عن ابن عمر قال: كنا في غزوة فحاصر الناس حيصة، كنا كيف نلقى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وقد فرنا ونزلت إلا متحرفا للقتال، فقلنا لا نقدم المدينة فلا يرانا أحد، ولو قدمنا فخرج النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من صلاة الفجر، قلنا نحن فرارون، قال أنتم العكارون، فتقبلنا يده قال أنا فئتكم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد، we continue the explanation of the kitab Al-Adab Al-Mufrad by Imam Al-Bukhari rahimahullahu ta'ala. And we begin the chapter Babu Taqbeel Al-Yad, the chapter of kissing the hand. Kissing the hand when greeting one another was not a common practice amongst the Salaf. And it was narrated that some of the Salaf used to practice this, but it wasn't a common practice amongst them, nor was it done frequently. And some of the ulama have stated that it can only be done to the people of virtue, like a person's parents, or the leader of the believers, or someone in a place of authority and station, and the people of knowledge. And it shouldn't be done for a person for any means of the dunya. So it should only be a person who the sharia has given a fadl to, a virtue to. Also, some of the salaf rejected it completely. Like Imam Malik rahimahullahu ta'ala, he said, no one should do this. Because there is a level of, a person has to lower himself slightly. And some of the salaf used to call this the minor sajda. And because of this, some of them prohibited this. So the ulama have mentioned that generally speaking, a person should avoid this. But if it is with his parents, then there is no problem, or with the ulama, and they shouldn't do it every time they meet. And it is better for them to raise their hand than to lower themselves. So if they were to kiss the hand of their parents, it is better for them to raise the hand of their parents to them than to lower themselves to kiss the hand, because lowering themselves to kiss the hand is resembling the ruku'. It's resembling the ruku'. So if a person was to raise their hands up, then he is not resembling the ruku', and there is no inhina, any type of bowing and lowering oneself. But if a person was to lower himself to their hands, then he is resembling the ruku', and we should not resemble acts of ibadah. So it is permissible, but it should be avoided in most cases. And the ulama say there is no problem if it is with the parents or if it is with Ahlul Ilm or Ahlul Fadl. But it shouldn't be taken as a habit that every time you see them, that this is the practice. So this is the chapter Babu Taqbeel Al-Yad. The author rahimahullah ta'ala, in this chapter, he begins with the hadith of Abdullah ibn Umar. And this hadith is da'if because of Yazid ibn Abi Ziyad. Ibn Umar, he says, كنا في غزوة, that we were in a battle. فحاص الناس حيصة, and the people, they retreated. And the reason, and this type of word that's used, فَحَاصَ, it means that they retreated strategically and not retreated to run away from the battle. So they retreated strategically from the battle. قُلْنَا, so we said, كَيْفَ نَلْقَ النَّبِيَّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ وَقَدْ فَرَرْنَا. They said, how are we going to meet the Prophet ﷺ now that we have fled? Because when they fled from this, they retreated. Obviously they fled from the battle, but this wasn't out of being like cowards in the battle. It was a strategic type of fleeing. فَنَزَلَتْ إِلَّا مُتَحَرِّفًا لِقِتَالٍ. Then Allah Jalla wa'ala revealed the verse, إِلَّا مُتَحَرِّفًا لِقِتَالٍ, that you are allowed to retreat if you are going to, if it's a strategic type of retreating. فَقُلْنَا لَا نَقْدِمُ الْمَدِينَةِ فَلَا يَرَانَا أَحَدٍ. But they were scared. They said, we will not enter Medina, so no one will see us. فَقُلْنَا لَوْ قَدِمْنَا. So we said, what about if we were to, let's go there, maybe if we go there, we'll see what will happen. فخرج النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من صلاة الفجر. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he came out from Fajr and he saw them there. قلنا نحن الفرارون. They said to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, we are those who have fled. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he had received the revelation إلا متحرفا لقتال, except if they retreat as a strategic move. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, أنتم العكارون. Rather, you are al-akkarun. Al-akkarun are those who repeatedly go back and they fight in jihad fi sabilillah. فَقَبَّلْنَا يَدُهُ. So they said, we kissed the hand of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he said, أَنَا فِئَتُكُمْ. I am part of you and I am from your party. Now this hadith is da'if. This hadith is da'if about them kissing the hand here of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and this hadith is da'if in general. But we do find the permissibility of kissing the hand. And if they were to kiss the hand of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam like this, then this wouldn't have been a problem. As the general position of kissing the hand is permissible, is permissibility, but it should be avoided as much as possible. No.
قال رحمه الله تعالى حدثنا ابن أبي مريم قال حدثنا عطاء بن خالد قال حدثني عبد الرحمن بن يزيد قال مررنا بالربزة فقيل لنا فقيل سعيد بن الأقوع وأتيناه فسلمنا عليه أخرج بيديه وقال بايعت بهاتين نبي الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فأخرج كفا له ضخمة كأنها كف بعير فقمنا إليها فقبلناها.
The author رحمه الله تعالى mentions the narration of Abdul Rahman ibn Razim. He said مررنا بالربذة, that we went past a place, and this is Rabadha, is a place which is close to Medina. So we went past this place, Rabadha. فَقِيلَ لَنَا, it was said to us, هَاهُنَا سَلَمَةُ بْنُ الْأَكْوَعُ. It was said to us that this is سَلَمَةُ بْنُ الْأَكْوَعُ. And who is سَلَمَةُ بْنُ الْأَكْوَعُ? He is a companion of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. فَأَتَيْنَاهُ فَسَلَّمْنَا عَلَيْهُ. So we went to him and we greeted him, we gave him salams. فَأَخْرَجَ يَدَيْهِ, and he showed us his hands. فقال بايعت بهاتين نبي الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. He said, I gave the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم the pledge with these two hands, meaning showing them that he is a companion of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. And the reason why the companions would inform those who came to them that they were companions is that so they would, when they give them knowledge, they will accept the knowledge from them. If a person doesn't know who someone is and he's telling you about the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and he's telling you about the Sunnah, maybe you will not trust him in his knowledge. So the Sahabi will say, these are the two hands that are used to give the pledge of allegiance to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. فَأَخْرَجَ كَفًّا لَهُ دَخْمَةً كَأَنَّهَا كَفُّ بَعِيرٍ. And he took a hand of his out, which was a very large hand, like it was a hand of an animal. It was a very large hand. فَقُمْنَا إِلَيْهَا فَقَبَّلْنَاهَا. And we stood to his hand and we kissed his hand. So here it shows that they kissed the hand of a Sahabi. And this hadith is authentic. That they kissed the hand of the Sahabi. And the Sahabi did not rebuke them for kissing the hand. So this shows the permissibility of kissing the hand of the people of virtue. And the ulama say that it is permissible to kiss the hand, as mentioned before, but the one who is going to have his hand kissed, it is not permissible for him to initiate this. So sometimes you find that certain people put their hands out and expect everyone to kiss them. And this is not from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and many of the ulama have prohibited this. Like one of the mashayikh, he was saying that he was sitting in a dars once in Misr, in Egypt, and someone, one of the sheikhs, he came into the masjid and he put his hand out and everyone was kissing the hand and kissing the hand until they got to the sheikh and he didn't kiss the hand. So then he became angry and he expelled him from the gathering because he never kissed the hand. He said, this is nothing from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If he stands up and he kisses the hand, then this is up to him if he wants to do this. But to put your hand out and make people kiss it, then it's not known, it's not a known practice of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam or his companions or the salaf. So some of them will kiss the hands, but they will not initiate this and they will not put their hands out. And there is no harm in kissing the hand, and that's why they say the people of virtue, because they are going to be further away from riba and further away from being amazed by themselves, meaning of ujb. So they will have less of these diseases in their hearts, so it is permissible with them. No.
قال رحمه الله تعالى حدثنا ابن الله بن محمد قال حدثنا ابن عيينة عن ابن جدعان قال ثابت لأنس أمسست النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بيدك قال نعم فقبلها.
طيب, the author رحمه الله تعالى mentions the narration of ثابت. He says قال ثابت لأنس. ثابت, he said to Anas. Who is this ثابت? He narrates from Anas quite a lot. What is his name? ها؟ ثابت ال بناني ثابت البناني. He narrates from Anas. He used to spend time, a lot of time with Anas, and he used to serve Anas. ثابت البناني. He said, قال ثابت لأنس. That ثابت, he said to Anas, أمسست النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بيدك. That did you touch the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم with your hand? قال نعم. He said yes. فقبلها. So he kissed his hand. And this narration is ضعيف. This narration is ضعيف because of Ibn Jud'an. And because of Ibn Jud'an, the hadith is ضعيف. But again, there is no problem. And Imam al-Bukhari mentioned these narrations to show that there is no problem with a person if he was to kiss the hand of the people of ilm and fadl. No.
حدثنا موسى بن إسماعيل قال حدثنا مطر بن عبد الرحمن الأعنق قال حدثتني امرأة من صباح عبد القيس يقال لها أم أبان ابنة وازع أن جدها أن جدها الزراء ابن عامر قال قدمنا فقيل ذاك رسول الله وأخذنا بيديه ورجليه نقبلها.
باب تقبيل الرجل. The chapter of kissing the feet. Is it permissible to kiss the feet in al-Islam? The ulama have mentioned with regards to kissing the feet that it is permissible to kiss the feet of the parents, and also permissible to kiss the feet of the people of virtue, with the condition that the person does not do inhina, that he does not lower himself down and bow. So how is this possible? If a person is sitting down on the floor and his parents maybe are sitting on a chair, then it is easy for them to hold their feet and to kiss it. So from this angle, there is no problem in them doing this. And again, there is nothing authentic in the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ about this. That the Prophet ﷺ used to allow people to kiss the feet or used to prohibit it. But we know that general inhina should not be done. A person should never lower himself like in the position of ruku' or sujood. But if a person was sitting down and his parents, their feet were there in front of him because they were sitting up in front of him, then he was to kiss their feet like this. And this is a sign of respect to them, then there is no problem in this. And the ulama said this shouldn't be something which is done all of the time. So if it was done now and then to their parents, and it is from their custom to do this, then there is no harm in them doing this. But they shouldn't, like while their parents are standing up and they are standing, they shouldn't go down into the position of sajda and kiss their feet, because this will resemble the sajda. So this is the general position of kissing the feet. The author here, he mentioned the narration of Aban Ibn al-Wazi', and she is unknown, and because of her the hadith is da'if. She narrates from her grandmother, أن جدها الزارع ابن عامر قال, that her she narrates from her grandfather, that her grandfather زارع ابن عامر, he said قدمنا فقيل ذاك رسول الله, we went and we proceeded and it was said to us that this is the messenger of Allah. فَأَخَذْنَا بِيَدَيْهِ وَرِجْلَيْهِ نُقَبِّلُهَا. So we took his hands and his feet and we kissed it. And this hadith is da'if, and there's nothing authentic in the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ that they kissed his feet. No. قَدْ رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى حَدَّثْنَا عَبْدُ الرَّحْمَنِ بْنُ
قَالَ حَدَّثْنَا سُفْيَانُ بْنُ حَبِيبٍ قَالَ حَدَّثْنَا شُعْبَةٌ قَالَ حَدَّثْنَا عَمْرُ عَنْ ذَكْوَانَ عَنْ صُهَيْبٍ
Now the author mentions the narration of Suhaib, and Suhaib is unknown, and because of Suhaib the hadith is da'if. He said, رَأَيْتُ عَلِيًّا يُقَبِّلُ يَدَ الْعَبَّاسِ وَرِجْلَيْهِ. I saw Ali kissing the hands and the feet of Al-Abbas, and Al-Abbas was his uncle. So the ulama said this hadith is da'if, but if Al-Abbas was sitting on a chair or a high place, and Ali radiallahu anhu was sitting on the floor and he kissed his foot from this place, then there is nothing wrong with this, because he's his uncle and his uncle has a virtue over him in al-Islam. No.
قال رحمه الله تعالى باب قيام الرجل للرجل تعظيما حدثنا آدم قال حدثنا شعبة وحدثنا حجاج قال حدثنا حماد قال حدثنا حبيب بن الشهيد قال سمعت أبا مجلس يقول إن معاوية خرج وعبد الله بن عامر وعبد الله بن الزبير قعود فقام ابن عامر وقعد ابن الزبير وكان أرزمه قال معاوية قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم صره أن يمثل له عباد الله قياما فليتبوأ بيتا من النار.
The author rahimahullah ta'ala says, Babu qiyami rajuli lil rajuli ta'zeeman. The chapter of a man standing for another man in veneration. So we said if a person is doing this out of respect, then it is permissible and it's better to avoid. But it is not permissible for a person to stand up for someone as an act of ibadah or as an act of ta'zeem, to venerate him and to magnify him. So this is what Imam al-Bukhari is pointing out to in this hadith. He mentioned the narration of Aba Mijlaz. He said, Inna Muawiyah kharaj. Now Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, he left. Wa Abdullah ibn Amir wa Abdullah ibn Zubair qu'udun. And these two men, they were sitting down. فَقَامَ ابْنُ عَامِرٍ. So Ibn Amir, he stood up. وَقَعَدَ ابْنُ الزُّبَيْرِ. And Ibn Zubair, he remained seated. وَكَانَ أَرْزَنُهُمَا. أَرْزَنَهُمَا, Ibn Zubair was the heavier of the two. قَالَ مُعَاوِيَةُ. So Muawiyah, he said, قَالَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ, that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, مَنْ سَرَّهُ أَنْ يَمْثُلَ لَهُ عِبَادُ اللَّهِ قِيَامًا. Whoever it makes happy that the slaves of Allah stand up for him, فَلْيَتَبَوَّأْ بَيْتًا مِنَ النَّارِ, then let him reserve a house for himself in the fire. So he said, whoever is happy that someone stands up for him, like he wants the people to stand up for him, or he encourages them to stand up for him, then let him reserve his house in the fire. So this shows the prohibition of someone asking people to stand up for him in ta'zeem, as magnifying him, he would say, stand up for me. How can you sit down like this? So you find this, and you find, subhanAllah, some of the arrogant people, they do this. And some of the people of pride and kibar and wealth, they do this. And I witnessed it myself, that there was a time, subhanAllah, we went to the ministry for Hajj when we were in the room and we were discussing certain things, and someone came from the ministry to speak to one of the members. So he was speaking to them and he said, do not sit down like this and talk to me, stand up. So he made him stand up in front of him to talk to him. And this, subhanAllah, this brings how the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ have been forgotten by many people today. That if the people were to implement the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, it will remove the kibr from their hearts. And it will move the arrogance and the pride from the way they speak and the way they act. So many people still have these things that they want people to stand up for them because they think they are people of position. But this is something the Prophet ﷺ said, if this makes you happy that people are standing up for you and you are encouraging this and you are calling to this, then reserve for yourself a house in the fire of Jahannam. So this shows you the sincerity of Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, how he was not pleased with this man standing up for him. And he wanted to close the door for anyone standing up for him because this could lead to pride in his heart. So he said, so he narrated this hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Naam.
قال رحمه الله تعالى باب بدء السلام. حدثنا عبد الله بن محمد قال حدثنا عبد الرزاق قال اخبرنا معمر عن همام عن ابي هريره عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال خلق الله عز وجل ادم صلى الله عليه السلام على صورته وطوله 60 ذراعا ثم قال اذهب فسلم على اولئك نفر من الملائكة جلوس فاستمع ما يحيونك به فإنها تحيتك وتحية ذريتك فقال السلام عليكم فقال السلام عليك ورحمة الله فزادوه ورحمة الله وكل من يدخل الجنة على صورته فلم يزل ينقص الخلق حتى الآن.
The author rahimahullah ta'ala says, Babu Bad' al-Salam, the chapter of the beginning of the salam. So how did the salam begin with the creation? So he begins with this hadith to show how Allah Jalla wa'ala legislated the salam for the creation. He mentions the hadith of Abi Huraira radiyallahu anhu wa arda. And this hadith of Abi Huraira is muttafaqun alayh. He says, عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال, that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, خلق الله عز وجل آدم صلى الله عليه وسلم على صورته. That Allah جل وعلا, He created Adam on His image. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam on His image. On whose image did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala create Adam? On whose image? On the image of Adam? Allah created Adam on the image of Adam? He created him as he was a man. Or did Allah Jalla wa'ala create Adam on the image of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala?
That's for the Christians.
Allah Jalla wa'ala created Adam alayhi salam on the image of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why it came in another narration that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam ala surati ar-Rahman. That He created him on the image of ar-Rahman. And this was being authenticated by Ishaq ibn Rahwaya. And also Imam Ahmad used this narration as evidence. And when Imam Ahmad was asked, what do you say about those who say that Allah created Adam on the image of Adam? Imam Ahmad said, this person has said the statement of the Jahmiyyah. And it was known from the Salaf that all of them, they agreed that Allah Jalla wa Ala created Adam on the image of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. That we affirm a surah, an image for Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. And Allah Jalla wa Ala created Adam on this image. And the only one we really know from the Salaf that denied this was Imam Ibn Khuzaymah rahimahullah ta'ala. In his Kitab al-Tawheed, he denied this. And he said, how could we say that Allah Jalla wa Ala created Adam on the image of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, because there is nothing like Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. So Allah created Adam on the image of Adam. And this was then promoted by some of the mashayikh of the Asha'ira and the Maturidiyya and other than them. But the Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah were very clear. And Ibn Khuzaymah, he was completely correct in all of his kitab, except for the mas'ala of the surah. And that's why Fakhruddin al-Razi, when he spoke about Kitab al-Tawheed of Ibn Khuzaymah, he said, it is better we call this Kitab al-Shirk. And he said, because he was an Ash'ari, and he said he made everything was wrong in his kitab, except for what he said about the surah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam on the image of Adam. So all of the Salaf, they unanimously agreed, except for Ibn Khuzaymah, that Allah Jalla wa Ala created Adam on the surah of Ar-Rahman. And this is the Aqeedah of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. And from the contemporary scholars, all of our scholars have agreed to this, and the only one that differed was Shaykh al-Albani. Shaykh al-Albani was the only scholar that differed from the scholars of Ahlul Sunnah of our time about this, and then his students, they followed him in this. And that's why you find Shaykh ibn Baz affirmed this, and Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen affirmed this, and Shaykh ibn Jibreen affirmed this. And all of the scholars, they affirmed it, and the only one who took the view of Ibn Khuzaymah was Shaykh al-Albani. And he gave very harsh statements to try and prove the view of Ibn Khuzaymah, even though all of the Salaf, they rejected the view of Imam Ibn Khuzaymah rahimahullah ta'ala. To the extent, as Imam Ahmad, as I mentioned, that Imam Ahmad, he said that whoever says this has said what the Jahmiyyah have said, or whoever said this is a Jahmi. So this was their view. So what does it mean that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam on the image of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The ulama have explained this hadith, salafan wa khalafan. And they said the meaning of this hadith is Allah Jalla wa Ala created Adam alayhi salam sami'an, basiran, mutakalliman. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam alayhi salam as someone who could see, someone who could hear, and someone who could speak. And this is the meaning that Allah Jalla wa Ala created Adam alayhi salam on his image. That someone who could speak, and someone who could hear, and someone who could see. And this also affirms an image for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But it doesn't mean that if Allah jalla wa ala created Adam on an image of Allah jalla wa ala, that he is like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Allah jalla wa ala says in the Quran, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ, that nothing is like him. وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ, but he is the all-seer, the all-hearer, the all-seer. So in this verse, Allah Jalla wa Ala negates the creation looking like him subhanahu wa ta'ala, but then he affirms two attributes that he has, that he has given to the creation. And he affirms in this verse the attribute of hearing and the attribute of sight and seeing. So when he attributes these two verses, two attributes, can we say that the creation are like Allah Jalla wa Ala in their hearing? Can we say this? No, because if we say this, we are rejecting the first part of the ayah. And if we say the creation are like Allah Jalla wa Ala in their sight, then we are rejecting the first part of the ayah, that nothing is like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if we say the creation do not see and do not hear, then we are rejecting the second part of the ayah. So this shows us that we affirm attributes for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we affirm attributes for the creation, but we say that they are not like the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when Allah jalla wa ala created Adam alayhi salam on his image, that Allah jalla wa ala created him as someone who could see, and someone who could hear, and someone who could speak, it means that Adam has an image, but his image is not like the image of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It doesn't resemble the image of Allah jalla wa ala completely. And this is like a person now, he sees the image of the moon in the sea. When a person sees the image of the moon in the sea, and this was the example given to us by our Shaykh Abdul Aziz al-Rajihi, when we asked him about the hadith of the surah, he said, when you look at the sea, you see the moon in the sea. And this is the image of the moon. Does this resemble the moon? Yes, it resembles the moon. But is it like the moon? Is it like the moon in its size? Is it like the moon in its texture exactly? No, it is not. So there are differences between the image of the moon in the sea and the actual image. So if we can understand that there is a difference between the moon, something that we see above us, and they're in front of us in the sea, and we can understand there is a difference between them, even though that was an image of that which is in the sky, then how can we not understand this hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? So this was the answer of our Shaykh Abdul Aziz Al-Rajihi. So we say Allah Jalla wa Ala created Adam alayhi salam on his image. So Allah Jalla wa Ala created Adam alayhi salam sami'an, basiran, mutakalliman, as someone that could hear, and someone that could see, and someone that could speak. But Adam does not resemble Allah Jalla wa Ala, because Allah said, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ, that nothing is like him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he said, وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٍ, and no one is like him subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we affirm the surah, the image of Allah Jalla wa Ala. And this ayah, this hadith, as the ulama have mentioned, is a hadith that affirms the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is a hadith that affirms the attributes of Allah jalla wa ala. So we affirm from this hadith the surah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there are many hadith that affirm that Allah jalla wa ala has an image. Many a hadith that affirm that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has an image. Like when Allah jalla wa ala will come to the believers on Yawm al-Qiyamah, and he will come to them in an image that they do not recognize. He will come to them in an image that they do not recognize. And then later he will come to them in his image. And then he will reveal his face, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the surah is something which is affirmed for Allah jalla wa ala, and it is an attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and something that Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah have accepted. So even though Shaykh al-Albani denied this hadith, or denied the meaning of this hadith, and he denied that Allah jalla wa ala has an image, it doesn't mean that his view in this is correct, and what he has done in this, and may Allah jalla wa ala have mercy on him and forgive him, but he opposed the view of the Salaf in this, and also the view of the scholars of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah from the later scholars as well. And as we know, the surah was affirmed, and this hadith was affirmed by the Salaf in general, and also by Ibn Taymiyyah and Ibn al-Qayyim, and even the ulama of our time, and the heads of them, as I mentioned, like Ibn Baz and Ibn Uthaymeen and Muhammad ibn Ibrahim and Ibn Jibreen and Ghudayyan, and even the ulama who are alive today, like Abdul Aziz al-Rajihi and al-Barraq and al-Ghunayman, and the ulama of Aqeedah who are known for their strength in Aqeedah of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, they all affirmed these ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Shaykh Hamoud al-Tuwayjiri, he has written a kitab on this, and the kitab is called Aqeedatu Ahl al-Iman fi Khalqi Adam ala Surat al-Rahman, the Aqeedah of the people of Iman with regards to Allah creating Adam on the Surah of al-Rahman. So he has a kitab where he refutes the claim of Ibn Khuzaymah and Shaykh al-Albani in this kitab, and then he proves how this was the Aqeedah of Ahl al-Iman, and that's why he called it Aqeedatu Ahl al-Iman, the belief of the people of Iman fi Khalqi Adam ala Surat al-Rahman, in the creation of Adam upon the image of al-Rahman. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, خَلَقَ اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ آدَمْ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ عَلَى صُورَتِهِ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam alayhi salam on his image, subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَطُولُهُ سِتُّونَ ذِرَاعًا, and then Allah jalla wa ala said, or the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, and the height of Adam alayhi salam is 60 cubits. ثُمَّ قَالَ اِذْهَبْ. Now when we say that Allah jalla wa ala created Adam on the surah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, are we saying Adam in his entirety? No, because in the other hadith the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, do not hit the face, because Allah jalla wa ala created Adam upon his image. So do not hit the face, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam on his image. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is speaking about the face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why the scholars said the attributes of the face of Allah jalla wa ala that we affirm are that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hears, and that he sees, and that he speaks, subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَطُولُهُ سِتُّونَ ذِرَاعًا, and Adam alayhi salam, he was 60 cubits tall. ثُمَّ قَالَ, then Allah said to him, اِذْهَبْ, go. فَسَلِّمْ عَلَىٰ أُولَٰئِكَ إِنْ نَفَرٌ مِّنَ الْمَلَائِكَةِ جُلُوسٌ فَاسْتَمِعْ مَا يُحَيُّونَكَ بِهِ فَإِنَّهَا تَحِيَّتُكَ وَتَحِيَّةُ ذُرِّيَّتِكَ. And then Allah Jalla wa'ala said, and go to them and give them salam. And this was a group of angels that were sitting down. And listen to how they greet you, because this will be your greeting and the greeting of your children. So Adam alayhi salam, he went to the malaika and he said, assalamu alaykum. How did he know how to say assalamu alaykum? Because Allah jalla wa ala said, fasallim ala ulaik, send them salam. So he said, assalamu alaykum. Faqalu, so the malaika, they said, assalamu alayka wa rahmatullah. They said, assalamu alayka, peace be upon you, wa rahmatullah, and the mercy of Allah. Fazaduhu wa rahmatullah, and they increased Adam in wa rahmatullah. فكل من يدخل الجنة على صورته. So everyone who enters Jannah, they are upon his image. Whose image is this referring to now? This is the image of Adam عليه السلام. So everyone who enters Jannah is upon the image of Adam عليه السلام. فلم يزل ينقص الخلق حتى الآن. And the creation are becoming smaller until today. Meaning Adam was 60 cubits, and the creation are going to become smaller and smaller and smaller until they meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this hadith is متفق عليه. And from this hadith we affirm some of the sifat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we also find that this is how the salam was initiated, where Allah jalla wa ala told Adam alayhi salam to give the salam to the malaika to see how they will respond to Adam alayhi salam. We also find that Adam alayhi salam was 60 cubits tall, and the people will enter Jannah in the image of Adam, meaning they will not be deficient in any form. And they will, even if they had deficiencies in this life, that they will have their limbs and they will not be deficient in any way or form. They will be like Adam alayhi salam, and they will also be taught like Adam alayhi salam when they go to Jannah. And the reason the ulama have mentioned why the believers will be taller and larger when they are in Jannah is because if they are taller and they are larger, then they will be able to feel more pleasure in Jannah, because there is more of their body that can feel the pleasure of Jannah. And likewise, the people of Jahannam, they will have a larger capacity, and therefore more of their body will feel adab in Jahannam. Now,
Allah rahmahu Allah ta'ala, bar ifsha' al-salam. Hadathna Musaddad, qala hadathna Abdul Wahid, al-Qalal ibn Abdillah, al-Nahmi, al-Abdul Rahman ibn Awsaja, al-Bara' ibn Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, qala,
the author rahimahullah ta'ala says, Babu ifsha salam, the chapter of conveying the greetings of peace. The chapter of conveying the greetings of peace. And as we know, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has commanded the believers to convey the greetings of peace to the believers. So the author rahimahullah ta'ala mentions narrations here to prove this. He begins with the hadith of Al-Bara ibn Azib radiyallahu an, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Afshu salam taslamu, that spread peace, meaning the greetings of peace, and you will find yourself in peace. Taslamu, that you will find yourself in a state of peace and security. And the ulama say that this word encompasses every type of peace and every type of security. So this tells a person that if he is living in a state of fear, or he is living in a state where he is not completely content and does not have that much peace, then maybe he is not spreading sufficient salam. So he should try and increase in the amount of salam that he conveys to the believers, and this will bring him peace from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No. And one of the reasons is because when a person conveys peace and blessings to others, the malaika say ameen, and also for you too. So this will be one way that he will increase in his peace. And the other way is that the people will respond to him and they will say wa alaykum salam. So this will also increase him in peace, because they will be making dua for him as well. Now,
Father rahimahullah ta'ala, hadithna Muhammad ibn Ubaydillah, qala hadithna ibn Abi Hazim, wal-Qa'nabi, عن عبد العزيز عن العلاء عن أبيه عن أبي هريرة عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال: لا تدخلوا الجنة حتى تؤمنوا ولا تؤمنوا حتى تحابوا، ألا أدلكم على ما تحابون به؟ قالوا: بلى يا رسول الله. قال: أفشوا السلام بينكم.
The author rahimahullah ta'ala mentions the hadith of Abi Huraira radiyallahu an. And this hadith is collected in the Sahih of Imam Muslim, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لا تدخلوا الجنة حتى تؤمنوا. You will not enter Jannah until you believe. So this shows you that Iman is a condition for paradise. And without Iman, without belief and Islam, there is no Jannah. So no disbeliever will be able to enter the Jannah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لا تدخلوا الجنة حتى تؤمنوا. You will not enter Jannah until you believe. ولا تؤمنوا حتى تحابوا. And you do not believe until you love one another. And this type of belief, ولا تؤمنوا حتى تحابوا, is the completion of one's belief, which is obligatory, that the believers have to love one another. And if they love one another, then they will complete their iman. And if they do not love one another, then they will not be able to complete their obligatory level of iman. ألا أدلكم على ما تحبون به. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, should I not inform you of something that will make you love one another? قالوا بلى يا رسول الله. They said, yes, O Messenger of Allah. قال أفشوا السلام بينكم, that spread salam amongst yourselves. So this is one of the reasons for a believer to increase in his iman. And one of the reasons for the believers to complete his iman, and one of the reasons for the believers to love one another, is that they will spread salam between themselves. No.
قال رحمه الله تعالى حدثنا محمد بن سلام قال حدثنا محمد بن فضيل بن غزوان عن عطاء بن سائب عن أبيه عن عبد الله بن عمرو قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم اعبدوا الرحمن واطعموا الطعام وأنشوا السلام تدخل الجنان.
The author رحمه الله تعالى concludes this chapter with the hadith of Abdullah ibn Amr. He said that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said اعبدوا الرحمن, worship Ar-Rahman, wa at'imu at-ta'am, and feed the poor with food, wa afshu as-salam, and spread the greetings, tadkhulu al-jinan, and then you will enter the paradise. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is mentioning a few things that will allow us to enter Jannah. U'budu ar-Rahman, the ibadah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is the condition. Without the ibadah of Allah jalla wa ala, a person will not be able to enter Jannah. Wa at'imu at-ta'am, and to feed the poor with food. And this is from the acts which are prescribed in the Sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there are types of feeding which are obligatory in Al-Islam, which is at the time of when? Eid. At the time of Eid, when the believer, they feed, when they give zakatul fitr. When they give zakatul fitr, then this type of feeding is obligatory in Al-Islam. Wa afshu salam, and to spread the salam with one another. All of these are reasons for a person to enter the Jannah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No. And when the Prophet ﷺ mentions give the salam, it is not just a greeting that a person greets a believer with. This shows you, subhanAllah, how Allah Jalla wa Ala and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wanted the believers to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala frequently. So when you say assalamu alaykum, you are making dua for your brother. So when you recall this meaning that I am giving him salam, I am making dua for him, this is why this brings you close. You're continuously making dua for your brothers and they are making dua for you. So the Muslim lives with dua, he lives between dua, he's making dua and supplicating to Allah Jalla wa Ala throughout his life. So every time we meet someone, we are not just greeting them. It's not like saying hello or good morning or something similar to this. We are saying, may the peace of Allah Jalla wa Ala be upon you. And may Allah protect you from every harm and hardship and every calamity and affliction. This is what we are saying when we are greeting them. So when a believer recalls this meaning, when he is greeting a believer, then it will have a greater impact in the love that they will have between them, and a greater impact in his iman, because now he knows he is doing an ibadah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he is not just greeting his brother, he is greeting him and he is making dua for him, and he is strengthening his ties with him and his bonds with him, and he is also increasing him in his iman and also his brother in his iman, because he has given him a reason now to reply to a salam and to also make dua. No.
قال رحمه الله تعالى باب من بدأ بالسلام. حدثنا أبو نعيم عن سعيد بن عبيد عن بشير بن يسار قال ما كان أحد يبدأ أو قال يبدأ ابن عمر بالسلام.
باب من بدأ السلام. The chapter of the one who initiates the salam. The chapter of the one who initiates the salam. In this chapter, Imam al-Bukhari wants to emphasize and stress the point that the one who begins with the salam and the one who initiates the salam is better than the one who receives the salam. And that's why the Muslim should always strive to be the one who extends his hands first, and the one who gives the salam first. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the hadith of Abi Umama radiallahu anhu, and this hadith is in the Sunan, he said, "Inna awla an-nasi billahi man bada'ahum bis-salam." That the people who have the most right in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are the ones who begin with the salam. The ulama say these are the ones who deserve the rahmah of Allah more than others. So those who have more right to the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are the ones who begin with the salam. Imam al-Bukhari begins with the hadith of Bushayr ibn Yasar, who said, مَا كَانَ أَحَدٌ يَبْدَأُ أَوْ قَالَ يَبْدَرُ إِبْنَ عُمَرْ بِالسَّلَامِ. That no one could ever precede Ibn Umar with the salam. So Abdullah ibn Umar, he would convey the salam before anyone could convey the salam to him, because he wanted this reward of beginning with the salam, because he knew that those who are going to be have more right for the mercy of Allah Jalla wa Ala are the ones who initiate the salam. So no one was able to beat and compete with Ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma with giving the salam. No.
قال رحمه الله تعالى حدثنا محمد بن سلام قال أخبرنا مخلد بن يزيد قال أخبرنا ابن جريج قال أخبرني أبو زبير أنه سمع جابر يقول يسمى الراكب على الماشي والماشي على القاعد والماشيان أيهما يبدأ بالسلام فهو أفضل.
The author rahimahullah ta'ala mentions the hadith of Jabir radiyallahu anhu wa arda. And he said, يُسَلِّمُ الرَّاكِبُ عَلَى الْمَاشِي. The one who is riding, he gives salam to the one who is walking. وَالْمَاشِي عَلَى الْقَاعِدِ. And the one who is walking, he should be giving salam to the one who is sitting. وَالْمَاشِيَانِ أَيُّهُمَا يَبْدَأُ بِالسَّلَامِ فَهُوَ أَفْضَلِ. And when two people are walking, whoever of them initiates the salam, then he is the better one. So the one who is riding, he is the one who should be giving salam to the one who is walking, because he's going to quickly go past him. So he can say the salam and that person will hear it and he will be able to respond. And because he's going to go past, so maybe this person will have to turn to see him, but if he just goes past quickly, he says the salam, then it is easier for him to give the salam to him first. And then, so he is the one who should give the salam to the one who is walking. And the one who is walking should give the salam to the one who is sitting. And this has also been narrated on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as though. So this over here is a statement of Jabir. And later in the Kitab, Imam al-Bukhari will mention the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which is also similar to this. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also mentioned that the young ones should give salam to the elderly. But it doesn't mean that that person should not give him the salam. If the young one is encouraged to give the salam, and the one who is riding is encouraged to initiate the salam. But if the person who was walking initiated the salam to the one who is riding, then he has done well, because he has preceded him with the salam. And the person who was riding, he lost the virtue of the sunnah of initiating the salam while he was the rider. So it is still permissible for a person to initiate the salam if he is walking to the one who is riding. And also the one who is sitting to the one who is walking. And also the one who is older to the one who is young. But this hadith means that the one who is riding, he should remember this and he should try and initiate the salam before anyone initiates it. And the one who is walking should try and initiate the salam to the one who is sitting. And the one who is young should initiate the salam to the one who is older. And if two people are together, then the best of them is the one who initiates the salam. So both of them should try and initiate the salam before the other person. No.
قال رحمه الله تعالى حدثني إسماعيل قال حدثني أخي عن سليمان عن عبد الرحمن بن عبد الله بن أبي عتيق أن ابن عمر أخبره أن الغبر وهو رجل من مزينة وكانت له صحبة مع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كانت له أوسخ من تم على رجل من بني عمرو بن عوف اختلف إليه مرارا قال فجئت إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فأرسل معي أبا بكر الصديق قال فكل من لقينا سلموا علينا فقال أبو بكر ألا ترى الناس يبدأونك بالسلام فيكون لهم الأجر إبداؤهم بالسلام يكون لك الأجر يحدث هذا ابن عمر عن نفسه.
The author rahimahullah ta'ala mentions the hadith of Al-Aghar al-Muzani radiyallahu anhu. Al-Aghar al-Muzani. وهو رجل من مزينة. He was a person from مزينة. وكانت له صحبة مع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. And he was a companion of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. كانت له أوسق من تمر. He had على رجل من بني عمر بن عوف. He had a large amount of dates that a person from بني عمر بن عوف owed him. So this person from Bani Amr ibn Auf, he owed Al-Aghar al-Muzani a large amount of dates. And also, as we know, a sa'a, a handful like this is called a mud. Four of these handfuls are called a sa'a. So this is the measurements in the Sharia. So four of these handfuls are called a sa'a. How many sa'a is a wasq? Huh? We took this, subhanAllah, many times before. Like an awsaq, the singular of an awsaq. 60 sa'a is a wasq. So he said this person had an awsaq. He had large amounts of dates that belong to Al-Aghar Al-Muzani radiyallahu anhu. اختلف إليه مرارا. And he went many times to him to get it, but the person was not giving it to him. فجئت إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. So I came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. فأرسل معي أبا بكر الصديق. So he sent Abu Bakr radiyallahu anhu with me. So this shows that if a person, he is unable to get his right, then he can go to the leader of the believers. Then the leader of the believers will appoint someone who is noble. Because if a noble person goes to claim the right, then the person will feel shy not to give the right. So out of all of the people, the Prophet ﷺ appointed Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu to go with Al-Aghar to retrieve his rights. فَقَالَ أَبُو بَكَرَ. Then he says, فَكُلُّ مَنْ لَقِينَا سَلَّمُوا عَلَيْنَا. So Al-Aghar, he said, everyone that we passed, they gave salam to us. So Abu Bakr, he said to him, أَلَا تَرَى النَّاسِ يَبْدَأُونَكَ بِالسَّلَامِ فَيَكُونُ لَهُمُ الْأَجْرِ. Do you not see that the people are initiating the salam to you? So they will take the reward. إِبْدَأْهُمْ بِالسَّلَامِ يَكُونُ لَكَ الْأَجْرِ. Be, initiate the salam to them, and the reward will be for you. So this is how Abu Bakr wanted to teach him. He wanted to let the people give, see how Al-Aghar is with giving the salam. And he found that the people were giving him salam first and he wasn't initiating it. So he said, look, do not let them precede you in salam. And this shows us the virtues and the benefits of spending time with the people of knowledge. That the people of knowledge, this is how subhanAllah the Sahaba were. If they were walking together, one of them will be teaching the other about Islam. Or they'll be revising Quran. Or they'll be doing something which is beneficial for their akhirah. And this is how they were. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu taught him a sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then it says, يُحَدِّثُ هَذَا ابْنُ عُمَرْ عَنْ نَفْسِهِ. The Ibn Umar, he mentioned this, like narration, and he's like he's speaking about himself, that's why he initiates the salam. So he initiates the salam because Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu told him this. And he initiates the salam because the one who initiates it is better than the other person. No.
قال رحمه الله تعالى حدثنا عبد الله بن يوسف والقعنبي قال أخبرنا مالك عن ابن شهاب عن عطاء بن يزيد عن أبي أيوب أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال لا يحل لامرئ مسلم أن يهجر أخاه فوق ثلاث فيلتقيان فيعرض هذا ويعرض هذا وخيرهما الذي يبدأ بالسلام.
The author rahimahullah ta'ala concludes this hadith or this chapter with the hadith of Abi Ayyub radiallahu anhu. And this hadith is muttafaqun alayh. And it has already come before in hadith number 399. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لا يحل لمرئ مسلم أن يهجر أخاه فوق ثلاث. It is not permissible for a Muslim to boycott his brother for more than 3 days. فيلتقيان فيعرض هذا ويعرض هذا. They meet each other, and this person turns away, and the other person turns away. وخيرهما الذي يبدأ بالسلام. And the best of them are the ones who begin with the salam. And this hadith has been explained previously, but again it emphasizes the point that the best of the believers is the one who initiates and who begins with the salam. And we conclude here, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to adorn us with the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and with the etiquettes of the kitab and the sunnah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to implement these ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and to make us beloved to him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa sallallahu wa sallam ala nabina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.